guys, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, last few looks. Pastor, I got a problem. I'm selling myself for the church. Selling my body parts. Who else wants to donate a kidney? Alright, let's just let you know. Yeah, it's a great idea. I don't mind cutting my hair or whatever. Maybe Asaph, or maybe the most painful thing for Asaph would be to wax his arms and legs. We stream live on our church Facebook page. Well, it's like Pastor Joel said, money is a big thing in our lives. But not just that. Did you know that money is a big thing in the Bible? God invented money. Did you think about that? The idea of money came from God. Economics, finance, all came from God. In the Bible, Jesus talks about money and finances 25% of the time. Alright? I got this off the internet. I don't know who's counting. But sounds like what I read when I read the Bible. Jesus talks about money, not just money, but possessions, material things, you know, lost coins, all these things, 25% of the time. The Bible contains 2,300 verses concerning money. Okay, some really awesome statistics. And on top of that, that's twice as many verses on money than on faith and prayer. So if you think you need to pray a lot, you need to think about money a lot as well. But not in a way of like how to get more money alone, but how to use money. God has a purpose and function for money in our lives. The purpose is to reveal God's glory. The purpose is for us to be taking part in God's stewardship, to be a steward of God, what God has given to us, and all that kind of things. And also, in the Bible, Jesus only spoke of the kingdom of God more often than money. So there are few things more important to Jesus than money. Out of the 30 parables, 19, almost two-thirds of it, is in an economic setting. Lost coin, parable of the talents, which Pastor Joel preached about, parable of the rich fool, and all these parables. Okay, almost two-thirds of the parables of Jesus are about money. And if you missed last week, here's a little bit of recap for you guys from last week. Okay, the click a few times. Last week, Pastor Joel talked about the parable of the talents and how important it is that we be good stewards. This is not his notes. These are my notes. Okay, because OSL requires you to take notes during church service, and my OSL is over, but I'm still doing it. How awesome is that? Alright? And God's way of doing things, God's economy is so different than ours. We talk about 5%, 3 point something, and all the points and points and points. But God talks about double portions, 2 times, 3 times, pressed down, shaken over, running over. Those are the God's kind of figures when it comes to investment and returns on investment for God. His economy is just completely different from ours. Whatever God gives to us, take. We are a Pentecostal church, and sometimes as Pentecostals, we value being poor a little bit too much. There's no value in being poor. There's not the same way that there's no value in being rich, apart from having things. Okay. Maybe Forbes might tell you you have a net worth. Your value is $3 billion or something like that. Okay, but apart from that, we don't need to be afraid of money, alright? But we need to be afraid of misusing money. So we should, whatever God gives, we should take and be good stewards of it. And time is the most precious commodity. It's not money also, end of the day. Because when we go to work, you're basically exchanging your time for money. And if you need it, one more promo, one final plug for our church, for Pastor Joel's message, you can find it on our Facebook page. So do that. That's last week. So we cannot deny that money is really important thing. And here's what people say about money. Even this is not from the Bible. Maybe it sounds like it. But it says that... Next slide, please. Next one. We'll pass that. Money can buy a bed, but it cannot buy sleep. Some of you are struggling with this, right? Okay. Money can buy books, but cannot buy wisdom. Money can buy food, but it cannot buy an appetite. And some, and we have, I have just this week, someone is telling me about not being able to eat or sleep well, especially not being able to sleep. And money can buy finery, but not beauty. Money can buy a house, but not a home. Some of our homes are, families are in shambles, in a wreck. We still have a house, but it's no longer a home. Money can buy medicine, but not health. Money can buy luxuries, but not culture or class. Sometimes the worst drivers are the ones with the most expensive cars. No class. Not real. Yep. Not Mercedes. Alright. Money can buy amusement. Some, you can ask someone to come and juggle for you. I can juggle. Pay me. I juggle for you. But it will not bring you happiness. Money can buy companions, but not friends. Money can buy flattery, but not respect. Now, I understand that as I'm speaking here, I'm looking at you guys, looking out. I can still see you guys. And I realized that some of you might be wondering, hey, my quote-unquote net worth or value is more than you, Pastor Lemon. Why should I listen to you? Okay. Now, the thing is this. You might be good at accumulating wealth, but it doesn't mean that you are good at handling wealth. Okay? I grew up in a very different environment. My dad, mom and dad were pastors. We grew up in the church. Back then, my parents were like pioneers. So the churches were very small, and I want to say that they could barely pay my parents, but no, they can't. They can't pay my parents. The church, we stayed in the church, my room was the Sunday school room. but the only real private place that we could have would be my parents' small room. Let's see. Maybe a little bit bigger than this half of the stage. Okay? And I remember times where things got more interesting. You know, sometimes, my mother cooks and the meat is sliced so thin that it's transparent. You can see. Alright, I understand that. His salary, quote-unquote salary, was, it was not that long ago, okay? I was probably in maybe before standard one, so that's like just 12 years ago. 30 years ago. Okay. I know that my parents, even at 300 ringgit at the time, that was still very little for a family. Only my dad was working and getting a salary, my mom was not. And that was the kind of environment I grew up from. I understand, I really took to heart Paul's words when he said, I know what it is to live with a little, and I know what it is to have an abundance. Alright? And the trick here is that if today, I always want to maintain this posture, that if today God says, go back to that lifestyle where you trust God, trust in me, and I will provide for you, I want to be able to say yes to God with no hesitation or as little hesitation as possible. Some of you don't know, some of you are first time here, but I have a family. I need to feed them. That would be probably the hardest part. If I was alone, it would be much easier. And so that is my background. And even now, I am not doing, if you want to compare, okay? We'll talk about comparing later. But if you want to compare between Joel, Asaph, and me, three pastors in this church, I use them as an example because some of you might get upset when I compare with you, but I am probably, in that sense, one of the lowest paid persons in this church. And most of you know it. Because most of you know my salary, most of you know how much I make from school. Yes, Lucas! Okay. Yes, she does. Alright, so, I'm talking to you guys, some of you guys, are like, you have ACCA la, what CPA la, CMA, what CFA, whatever your degree or your master's or whatever alphabet it is behind your name, I have none. I don't have. It's just me. Just Daniel. Not even my real name. Yi Nam Fong. That's my real name. Okay? So that's all I have. But you need to hear what I say, because today, what I'm going to bring to you is not just from my experience, but more importantly, it's based on the Word of God. And these principles might sound familiar to you, like, hey, I attended this seminar, or I sat through this class, and the speaker said the exact same things. Now, I want to tell you this. Truth said by someone else does not make it less truth. If Buddha said it and it's a truth, it agrees with the Bible, I say, yes, why not? If another religious teacher or preacher comes and says a certain truth, that you should love your neighbor, I'll say, yes, I totally agree that I should love my neighbor. Doesn't matter who says it. If your lecturer on finance or economics said it, and you're hearing it from me again, but I'm going to tell you where it came from. It came from the Bible. It says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, that there's nothing new under the sun. Everything that is, has been before, has been done before, and will be done again. You know, it's just like fashion. You keep your clothes long enough, you'll come back into fashion. That's what it means. Okay? There's nothing new under the sun. Okay? And if it is a timeless principle, it's been there since the beginning. So, today, let's go into this. We're going to be quite fast-paced. I put up all the verses that we're going to have onto the screen, because I want you guys to take down notes. Okay? OSL people, you already have to take down notes. But if not, I know that you guys use your smartphones for your Bibles. But today you don't have to use your own Bible app. Just open a notepad or even your email, and then just send it to yourself or keep it as a draft or whatever. Here we go. So, 10 commandments. We're going to do this. It's like a top 10 list. Okay? Let's go to the first one. And this is probably the most important one. Thou shalt remember who the source is. When we talk about 10 commandments, you have to have thou shalt die and all that kind of thing, right? So thou shalt remember who the source is. Psalms 24 verse 1, as you can see there, I'm picking certain versions to bring out the meaning of the verse even more. This is from NLT, you can see there. You can go back and check later, you know, make sure I got the right verse and all that. But Psalms 24 verse 1 says that the earth is the Lord and everything in it, the world and all its people belong to Him. Everything belongs to God. You know why or not? Do you know why everything belongs to God? You read down a little bit, verse 2 or whatever. It's because He created it. If you drew the Mona Lisa, you drew it. It might be hanging in somebody's house, somebody else's house now. But it still belongs to you because you are the one who created it, you made it. And until you sell it, it's yours. All, everything in the world belongs to God. Now, in this theological journal that I read called Reader's Digest, a traveler was traveling. Okay, it's not a theological. Some of you, please don't go and look up theology on Reader's Digest. A traveler was, taking a flight somewhere, and so she was transiting. She decided to go to the airport lounge and buy a pack of cookies. Okay? Airport cookies are very expensive. And she bought a newspaper to read. So as she bought her stuff ready, she sat down and she took up a newspaper and began to read. And she heard some rustling, like someone's opening up a pack of cookies. And so, rustle, rustle, rustle. After a while, she was like, cannot stand, lowered the newspaper and saw, hey, someone opened that pack of cookies and is eating. There's this man eating my cookies. Then she didn't want to create a scene or anything. This is an airport. You get special searches in the airport. And lowered, then she just leaned over and picked one piece of cookie. And then later she heard some more rustling, and the man took another piece of cookie. And so she's like, Then she also picked one up. One more. So this went on for a while until the last cookie. There was one last cookie. And the man broke the cookie in half and put half down and ate half. After that, she took the half, and she was so upset, she threw it away. And then as her flight was, it was time to board her next flight, she realized, hey, wait a minute, my cookie is still in my bag, my pack of cookies. That pack of cookies was not mine. Sometimes the thing is this, when we know, when we really understand who's the source is, who it belongs to, we have such a different view on things, right? So we need to remember who the source is. Don't forget that God is the source. Okay? Your money is in your pocket, but it's not your money. the house that is written, that has your name on it, or your car that has your name on it, it's not yours. Remember who the source is. You are a steward of it. Be a good steward of it. Sometimes people are so afraid to come to God because God has been presented as this person that likes to take your things. When you come to God, you've got to give Him your heart, give Him your soul, give Him your everything, give Him your decisions, give Him your fun because He's such a party pooper. But you know what? That has been wrongly presented. God has been misrepresented to us and to the people outside of church. Because I know that God is not a taker. In fact, He's not even a giver. He's an outgiver. God doesn't just give like you. Okay, you give me 10 talents, I give you back 10 talents. It's not even that way. The Bible talks about if you give, it will be given back to you. It will be pressed down, it will be shaken together, it will be running over. God is an outgiver. God is an extravagant giver. And then God will be like, what? There's more where that came from. So when you think that, please don't think that, sometimes we, I understand that sometimes it's painful to give, especially when times are tough. It's painful to give. But remember that when we give, we can never outgive God. God is the ultimate outgiver. On this, you can know that God is Gyasu. Okay? He will one-up you. He's this total one. He's going to totally one-upmanship you. Okay? You're going to give Him one, He's going to give you two. You give Him two, He's going to give you three. He's going to go on like that. You can try this with Him. Okay? So, God is not a taker. He's not even a giver in that fact. He's an outgiver. He's an extravagant giver. Our resources here on earth might be limited, but our source is unlimited. Remember that when you work in a certain place and that place pays you your salary, know that God is using your bosses and your company to pay you. Okay? At home, we all have taps at home. Okay? When we turn on the tap, we find water. When we want to drink water or when we want to wash stuff or anything, when we need water, we go to the tap. Okay? But the water did not come from the tap. It comes from somewhere else, a reservoir somewhere. And the reservoir somewhere holds so much water, comes from another place, comes from the rain, comes from a dam or something like that, and it comes from the sky, and it comes from God, ultimately. He is the ultimate source. If God closes one tap, He's going to open another tap. If God closes another tap, He's going to break open certain levees and certain dams in your life. So don't worry. And know that God is unlimited. Our source is unlimited. Let's move real quick. Next one. That's number one. Thou shalt remember who the source is. Number two. Thou shalt work diligently. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 to 25. And don't just do the minimum that will get you by. Do your best work from the heart for your real master, for God, confident that you get paid in full when you come into your inheritance. Keep in mind always that the ultimate master you're serving is Christ. The silent servant who does shoddy work will be held responsible. Being a follower of Jesus doesn't cover up for bad work. Hey, you hear that, guys? This verse is special for you, Christians. All of us. Being a Christian is no excuse for crappy work, for low quality work. When you do something, do it with pride. Do it with passion, do it with excellence. There needs to be a spirit of excellence. Okay? That when you do it that way, people will be drawn to you. God will be glorified through your work. Do you know that wherever you're working, you didn't choose it alone? And if you did, you really shouldn't. You should seek God. Who should you work for? Where should you work? You should seek God for these kind of things. Because it is God who's going to put you there. It is God who's going to use you in that place. It is God who's going to provide for you at that place. Okay? So seek God. And then in all things, and some of you who have recently maybe started work and have been in touch, maybe closer with me, and you guys have been talking to me. Some of you, when you start work, I send this verse to you on your first day or first week of work. Be excellent at your work. And most importantly, remember, you're not doing it for that boss, Mr. Liu, or whatever his name is, okay? You're not doing it for your boss. Have this in mind that you're doing it for the Lord. Perform well. Do it for God. Sometimes even when it comes to work in church, sometimes our churches have such a bad culture that it's like, ayah, just no money lah. So, you know, we do things very chintai lah. But no, do things well here. And some of you, maybe you're still college students and you're helping out in church. Let me tell you this. I have, so far, it's 100% track record. If you are not excellent in your work in church, you will not be excellent in your work outside of church. I've had people who ask me as a youth leader in the past, recommend someone for part-time work, and so I recommend certain names, or this one after SPM, can consider, or finish PMR. Oh, then this person will go and PMR, SPM, and do some part-time work for 3 months, and then 1 week later, I come and talk to the boss. So how is it? How did he or she do? Oh, then they'll tell. It's like exactly the same thing that we deal with in church. That's always late to church, always late to work. Come to church, always like not ready, not awake. Go to work, same thing. So in the church is no different. Let's have a culture of excellence in this church, even as we are moving to our new place, new phase in life. Let's have a culture that we want to put in, that we're going to do things to the best we can, whether we have the money or not. Whatever God has given to us, we'd be good stewards of that. Okay? That's number two. Moving on. So remember, glorify God through your work. Number three, thou shalt not fall into debt. Okay? How many of you owe people money here? Bank? What else? Bank, right? Hopefully no. Huh? PTPTN? Oh no. Okay, that's a good loan. That's a good debt. Understand that there is good debt and bad debt. I'm talking here about falling into debt. Alright? I'm not talking about calculated risk. I'm not talking about good loans that you've taken so that you can own a home, start a family and all that. Talking about loans that go spiraling out of control. Loans where you go and swipe and get new bag, handbags. Alright? Not that kind of loan. Okay? It's simple. It's simple, but very often it's not easy. Simple. Spend less than you make. Don't spend more than you make. Okay? And many people attribute the quote to Will Smith, but who is not by him, it's an old quote by some Austrian guy, I think. It says, we buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't know. So true sometimes. Who are we trying to impress? But whoever said it, maybe Buddha, this is truth here sometimes. This is a very good observation, keen observation. And we need to, if you're doing that, it's time to stop. If you are in debt today, Pastor Joel said this now, I didn't tell him I'm going to say this or preach this, we didn't sing this. But if you're in debt, you can get out of debt. We have many, like I mentioned just now, many very qualified and highly skilled people in the area of finance that can help you. Okay? So if you're in debt, really, you don't need to be. Come and talk to us, let us help you, okay? Moving on, number four. Thou shalt teach your children about money. Okay? Since in the Ten Commandments, there was an honor, like father and mother, then you have long life. Then I put in this, because we need to leave a legacy. In Psalms 34 verse 11, the Message version says, come children, listen closely. I'll give you a lesson in God worship. Proverbs 22 verse 6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. You know, what a terrible... Children are a blessing. Alright? Children are a blessing. I got three already and I want more blessings still. Okay? But you know what a terrible curse it would be to have a rebellious son. A son that goes out, gets into bad debts, take loans, and then the loan shark comes and then harasses you, the family. If you don't teach your children, like it or not, is a reflection of the parent. teach your children in the way they should go. Even in the area of money, okay? If not, the parents who? You're waiting for who to teach your children. Now I want to tell you this story about a father one day who came back from a medical checkup. He had a band-aid on his arm because blood was drawn. And so the children came over, daddy's home. And then they came and welcomed daddy home and saw that daddy had a band-aid on the arm. So they asked daddy, what's this? What's that? Did you cut yourself? You know? And so daddy said, I have a medical checkup for the insurance that I bought. And kids don't know what is insurance, ask, what's insurance, daddy? So daddy, very as tenderly as he can, to cushion it for the children, say that, you know, if anything were to happen to daddy, because daddy loves you so much, if anything that might happen in the future, because we don't know the future, this insurance, if anything happens to daddy, will give you $250,000. And so one of the daughters, the eyes became really big, and like he asked the father instead, $250,000 a person? Sometimes, you see, how we value things transmits to our children. Teach our children to value the right things. Let's not use money to substitute love and presence. There's no substitute for that. You can't buy love. No money can buy love. If you do it the wrong way, your children are going to grow up valuing money over love. That's a terrible situation to have. So teach your children, while they are young, teach them. Let them have good habits starting now. That's number four. Moving on. Very fast, right? Told you it's going to be fast-paced. Number five. Thou shalt make plans for the future. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money, keeping with your income. Save it up. That's what the Bible says, okay? I'm not adjusting or anything, this NIV, but then this one is Good News Translation. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. It says, do not deceive yourselves. No one makes a fool of God. You will reap exactly what you plant. You see, we must know how, you know, we talk about growing wealth, growing money. Growing is the operative word. And what you need to know is that there's certain rules and certain laws that God has put in place in our universe. And it's universal. It's in our universe. Okay? For example, the law of the harvest is this, is that you reap what you sow. You don't put a durian seed into the ground and then expect apples to come out. Who does that? Put durian seed into the ground, come out durian fruit, and like, what? I was expecting it. Grapes! You don't do that. And the same thing goes with your money. What you reap is what you sow. That's rule number one. Law number one. Law number two is that you always reap later than you sow. You have to plant today if you want to have returns in the future. They say that the best time to plant a tree is 10 years ago. The second best time to plant a tree is today. So if today you're making money, you have access, stop making it rain on your mobile devices or gadgets or stuff, whatever it is that is your quote-unquote fetish, guitars, whatever it is, and start making plans. Start planting and growing your money today. It is good advice, okay? And finally, third law is that you always reap more than you sow. From one seed comes many fruits with many seeds. You can plant many more trees after that. Okay? Very natural, very easy to understand, and it applies. And God is telling us right here, is that He is not mocked. This is the law that He has set in place for us. Understand this, work on this, work by this law. Don't go and try to do this. Plant today, reap yesterday kind of thing. It doesn't work because it is a law. Law of nature. You can try to challenge it, but you're gonna learn a painful lesson. Now, whatever plan You know, there are many financial plans. Okay, you can try 1-6 jars, 7 jars, whatever it is, adopt something that works for you. Okay? Find something that works for you and stick to it. And plan as though Jesus is never coming back. Just plan as though you're going to live here and then you're going to die old age. Plan that way. But work as though Jesus is coming tomorrow. Start checking things off your list today. If it needs to be done today, do it today. Plant your tree today. Thou shalt have plan, make plans for the future. Number 6, thou shalt seek godliness and contentment. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6 to 7 says, yet true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave. Our culture teaches us that we should always want more. If you reach this level, then it's the next level. You don't think about it. Then the next level, then the next level. I'm not telling you that if promotions come along or a better offer come along, that you should reject it. I'm saying that you should think about it. And if you have come to a stage or a point in your life financially where, you know, you have everything you can want and you have savings already, you can retire, you know, when you reach a certain age, then cap your consumption. Okay? Continue to make more money if you can. Give it to the church. Give it to me. Give it to the needy. Give it to someone who needs it. Okay? Give it to charities. But at some point, we have to think, there must be a limit to some of these things. Cap our consumption. This is what Richard Branson says. Ridiculous yachts and private planes and big limousines won't make people enjoy life more. It sends out terrible messages to the people who are working for these things. Okay? It would be so much better if that money was spent in Africa or some other place that needs it. It's about getting a balance. Okay? And one of the richest men in the world also, Bill Gates, said this, I can understand wanting millions of dollars. There's a certain freedom, meaningful freedom, that comes with that. But once you get much beyond that, I have to tell you, it's the same hamburger. After you reach certain stage, that's enough. Know how to be contented as well. Learn to say, to thank God for it, and say, this is it, I'm set for life. Now what I need to do is focus on God's work. I need to devote myself more to God's work. Okay? And we're going to talk a little bit more about work later as well. The opposite of contentment is gluttony. Even if you have a lot already, you're full already, you cannot eat already, you still eat. You eat until you puke. Then after that, you come out from the toilet and you eat again. Gluttony sounds like a very cute sin. Very cute, fat fella. Okay, gluttony. But it is listed right next to sins, quote unquote sins like lust, envy, pride, wrath, greed, slothfulness. Gluttony is considered one of the 7 deadly sins by the church. Okay? Watch out for it if you do not know how to be contented. Okay? You might fall into another spiral. So seek godliness and contentment. Commandment number 7. Woo! We're blazing through this. How are we doing with time? Good. Okay. We're going to go faster. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. Oh, don't worry. We wouldn't dare say that we are as wonderful as these other men who tell you how important they are, but they are only comparing themselves with each other, using themselves as the standard of measurement. How ignorant. Law, commandment number 7 is, thou shalt not compare thyself with thy neighbor. Okay? Who was this? I have a quote here. Mark Twain says that comparison is the death of joy. I want to read another Bible verse to you. James 2 verse 5. Listen, my dear brothers and sisters. God has chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom He promised. Those who He loved, who loved Him. Every year, Forbes releases a list of richest people in the world based on their net worth. You know, sometimes it is so hard for us to get away from that kind of thinking. When we think about the person, we think, oh, this guy is ahead of me, on top of me, because he makes more than me. Oh, this guy is below me, because he makes less than me. Oh, this guy almost same with me, we're on par. It's very hard not to do it. I'm telling you that if you're going to do that, there will always be someone on top of you. The more you are on top, the more you're going to need money to spend. Do you know? What's important is that you know that you are blessed. Do you know that you are blessed? Today I'm speaking to Malaysians. Did you know that 50% of the world's population live on $1 a day? That's basically 4 ringgit. How many of you all make 4 ringgit a day? Most of us make easy 3,000 a day. Maybe 4,000. Let's make it 4,000. 4,000 a day. That is 4,000 a month maybe. Okay? We are 10 times better off than 52% of the world's population. Okay? We must know that we are blessed. In spite of things, that things could be better and all that, know that you are blessed. Now, one very hard-hitting reality hit me very hard during Chinese New Year. You know, Chinese New Year is a time to, you know, go very, very money, go crazy. And so we went for dim sum on one of the Chinese New Year mornings, and it was packed. Dim sum was packed because one of the first days that they opened, everyone wanted to have dim sum with family. And so I parked the car somewhere else and walked towards the packed dim sum shop. And along the way, there was this foreign guy. And he came to me, and you know, you recognize this scene. The guy asked me whether I want to buy belt, sir, pen, sir, toy. I'm like, what? Where? Because I was carrying my baby, and he was sleeping, maybe. I don't know. But he asked, buy all this. Then I said, no, I don't have any interest in any of what he has to offer. I have no interest at all. And so I just asked him, he said, hi, where are you from? Because nowadays we have a lot of Bangladeshis. He said he was a Pakistani. So I spoke to him, oh, I have Pakistani friends. Walking to the place, not much choice, because they're walking in the same direction. Same place, very awkward. No, I don't want to buy it, very awkward. So I asked him, okay? So this man, I realized that this man, so I asked him, what did he do? What does he do here? Is this part-time? And he's telling me, no, this full-time now. He has no other job. Okay? Do you realize that this man from Pakistan, he was a degree holder. Okay, he finished his studies. Many of you have degrees here. Okay, it's like you, education-wise. But he flew from away from his house, his home, thousands of miles, coming here to sell you what? Pens. 2 ringgit for 3. Belt, 20 ringgit. Thousands of miles. And here we are, sometimes complaining. If you want to compare, there are other things to compare. There are other ways to compare as well. Look around us, where we are seated. Look at what you're wearing. Cha-ching, you know, all looking good. Look at what you have in your hands, your devices. We are blessed. Know that for a fact. Number 8, thou shalt give generously. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 3. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means of their own accord. Proverbs 19 verse 17. If you help the poor, you are lending to the Lord, and He will repay you. No one has ever become poor by giving. Giving only makes us richer. Melinda Gates say that it is not unsound financial, let me get it right. Helping people doesn't have to be an unsound financial strategy, Melinda Gates says. And this other guy, John D. Rockefeller, some of you might know him, he's considered the richest man ever, okay? Think of giving not only as a duty, but as a privilege. Rich people agree, you need to give, okay? No one has become poor by giving. It is not just a Christian duty. If you're not a Christian and you're here today, you need to give too. I'm going to tell you this. Because if you do not know how to give, you do not know how to feel. And you have lost a lot more than just your money. Okay? Any financial plan, you go out there, search on the internet, ways to do personal money management, personal finance, budgeting, whatever, they will always say set aside money to be given away. Or charitable causes, whatever it is, to be given away, give to father, mother also, because that's your duty. Acts chapter 20 verse 35 says, In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus. How he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. When you give, it shows that you have access also. You have the ability to give. Isn't that good? Some do not have the ability to give. Maybe for a season. But you, while you have the ability to give, give. More importantly is that as Christians, you are giving. When you are giving, you're not just giving to that person, to the homeless or whatever. You're giving to the Lord. That's what the Bible tells us. Personally, here's a little small pet peeve of mine, which is I don't think we should pay tithes. I'm going to put it out there. You all say I can do it. Some of you pay tithes. I encourage you. Keep doing it. That's fine. But for me, I don't do it. Because if you want to engage me theologically, I can. But simply put is this. Even the Jews don't pay tithes now today. They don't pay tithes anymore. Okay? So, even Jews don't do it. And then I'm not a Jew even in the first place. So why are we paying tithes? But tithes is 10%. But for me, a New Testament Christian has a different standard to follow. And here it is. When you give, you need to have these four things. Okay? Is that you need to give cheerfully. That's for sure. Whether you are tithing or offering or whatever it is, you're giving 10% or 90%, give it cheerfully. If you're not giving cheerfully, please don't give. God doesn't need your pity. Okay? God is no beggar. Remember, He is the source, you know. He gave it to you. If you want to keep it, please go ahead and keep it. But don't like, take it and go leave me alone kind of attitude. Give cheerfully. Number two is this. Give consistently. Okay? Have a plan. For every Sunday or every month. Okay? Just now we read from 1 Corinthians chapter 16 that every first day of the week, every Sunday, you set aside money, bring it to the temple, to God's house, to the church, or whatever you want to call it. And then you have to give consistently. But now, we get our salary on a monthly basis. So I suggest you do that in a monthly fashion as well. Or whatever works for you. You want to do it annually, also can, but that's kind of difficult. You want to do it weekly, that's fine. But have a plan. Have consistency. That's one and two. Number three is this. Give sacrificially. Once again, God doesn't need it. But God wants it. Because God knows that where our treasure is, there our heart will be as well. God knows that if we love Him, we will want to give. Okay? Give sacrificially. And finally, for Christians, this is number four, applies to you. If you're part of a church, your church needs to be centered on giving. And all this is from 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Go and read 2 Corinthians chapter 8. You will find all this right there. And this is what I live by. And I'll tell you this. I'll make it known. I give more than 10%. I don't believe in tithes. But I make that my floor. Not my ceiling. I'm not going to give more than 10%. I'm going to give, I can give 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%, but not 10.1%. It's not the ceiling. I treat it as a floor. 10% is like minimum giving, suggested giving minimum. Okay? But I tell you, there's a greater way to give that God wants you to give. Give out of your love for God. Forget 10%, forget the number. Okay? If you love God, show it even in your giving. Okay? That's number eight. Yes, number nine. Second last. Thou shalt seek the counsel of the wise when it comes to money. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 4. Without good direction, people lose their way. The more wise counsel you follow, the better your chances. And then I rewind a bit now. Proverbs 11, verse 9. You can be ruined by the talk of godless people, but the wisdom of the righteous can save you. If you need rescuing, talk to some wise people. Talk to people who have the track record. Okay? Don't go and talk to the person who is bankrupt and have no money. Okay? Seek not just counsel, but wise counsel. Now, advice is given freely, but watch which one you take up, because that will cost you. Okay? seek advice, we here have not just the pastors, you guys have this benefit. The strange, it's a strange thing for me because from the churches that I, the church that I come from, the pastor is a full-time guy. It used to be my dad, then he was later someone else, but he works in church full-time. So sometimes pastors like that can be quite, how to say, in Malay it's katak di bawah tempurung. They are very myopic, they don't know what it means to manage finances. My dad was a little bit of an exception because he was an accountant before that, so he was the kind of guy. But in our church, you have the benefit of having three pastors, and all three of these pastors are working another job and pastoring you at the same time. Slightly different arrangements, each of us, okay? I like to think that I'm special, because I am, okay? Okay? I started out as a full-time pastor, okay? Joel and Asa started out as just business people or working people. And then in order for us to come together as a church, I took a pay cut and started working more in at my business to make money so that I can serve you. I can serve this church. I can serve God through serving you. Okay? Do I need to do this? No, ma. Just go get a proper job and then come and attend church and sit down and leave, and that's very comfortable. I can make a lot more money. And, you know, church work requires a lot of our attention. Really one. Okay? Sometimes we shield one another, between the three of us, we shield one another from certain information. I don't know if they do that. I do lah. Some things that I don't let it get to them. Because I settle it. Okay? Because I understand, you know, some we are all busy. Okay? You have, in the past, when I talk about money, I talk about it from a point where I'm the pastor, so I have to say these kind of things. But now I'm telling you that I'm also working just like you. By giving my Sundays and my spare time, whatever it is, Saturday mornings, I'm just like you, giving my best to God. And I encourage you, if you see this, follow that example. Okay? Not just me, but even Pastor Joel, Pastor Asaf, and sometimes we struggle and you know, sometimes we have to postpone our stuff so that we can come and do church stuff. But we know, we are not saying that, wow, big sacrifice. Yes, it is a sacrifice. But at the end of the day, we know that where there is a greater reward. We are going after the greatest prize. We are not going after the substitute prize, the here and now. But like Joel said last week, we are trying to live in an eternal state of mind. Alright? So, come to any one of us. We will do our best to help you. Okay? If you need financial counsel or anything like that. Finally, last one, number 10, and we're done for today, is this. Thou shalt prepare for your final audit. There will be a day of reckoning. There will be a day where we are called and we have to give account for what God has put into our lives. Like that master from the parable that Pastor Joel preached about last week. He went away and he came back and he called his servants back to him and said, what did you do with the talents that are given to you? There will be a day. That day will come. It could be today as you walk out of this place. It could be years later. But know for sure there will be a day when we will have to give an account. Matthew chapter 25 verse 23 says this. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Wealth is a wonderful tool, but a terrible God. If it is not God's money, then money is God. If you do not understand that the money you have is God, then money is your God. Jim Elliot, a famous missionary, died even before he was able to start his missionary work. And of course, for some of us, we know Jim Elliot from Derek Tan's email signature with Jim Elliot's quote. And this is the quote. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Do you think you're hanging on to your money because you can? Do you think you're hanging on to your life because it's yours to keep? You can't even keep your own life. You're not even in control of that. The wise man gives up what he cannot keep to gain that eternal prize that you cannot lose. That's what you need to do. Death is the greatest equalizer. All of us will die. And when we die, we all go just like the Bible verse we read. When we all came, we came with nothing. When we all go, we go with nothing. What remains is what we do for God. So today, that is the challenge for all of us. 10 things, so many things. But maybe today, 2 or 3 of these 10 things spoke to you. And I want to encourage you all, that whatever it is, to start today, do something about 10 things. Maybe it's all 10 things, but you don't have to deal with all 10 things. Just deal with the biggest problem. Start with 1 thing. The idea is not to be perfect. There's no perfection. But the idea is always progress. Keep moving forward. If you are stuck on one area, you cannot go, you cannot keep running, you have to slow down, don't slow down, but keep moving forward. If you have stopped, start running. If you have been moving backward, turn around and start moving the other way. So I encourage you guys today, even as I end. I'm just going to end right now. We're going to pray. Okay? Wherever we are, we're going to spend a few moments just being quiet before the Lord. There's a lot of information, it's like diarrhea of information, maybe all of that. But let's take some time to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Like in your own way, right? Just ask the Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit, speak to me. These 10 commandments of finance from the Bible, what is the area that you want me to deal with this morning? Let's just start where we are. All of us have progress to make. The rich, the poor, the ones doing well, the ones not doing well. All of us have progress to make. While we are on this earth, we cannot stop growing. Holy Spirit, come right now. Even as we remain silent before you, Holy Spirit, come and speak to us. Minister to us. Open our hearts and our ears to you. God, I thank you for these wonderful people here in our church. I thank you that they are here this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you have spoken to us this morning. We're certainly not here for nothing. You brought us here. You have something to say to us. Your words have been spoken. But right now, it's time for us to, even as it's time for us to end our meeting and go our separate ways, God, I pray that we will not leave without that word from you, O God. I understand that some of us here is dealing with certain financial problems. Almost every problem in life has a financial solution. Some of us might be losing sleep over finances or possessions. Some of us losing appetite. Some of us are seeking a job. We don't have anything to do. Some of us are struggling. Even for those who are not struggling, for some of us who are doing well, God, you have a word for us. You have a word that is going to unlock the floodgates of heaven. God, I pray right now that even as your Holy Spirit speaks to us in a still small voice, I ask the Holy Spirit to begin to tell us how to move forward. Give us ideas, oh God. Inspire us. Push us towards certain people or certain things or certain ideas, oh God. God, I pray that you begin to open doors for our church members, oh God. Doors that will bring us to greater heights, oh God. Not so that we can make more and live more comfortably, but so that we can serve you more, oh God. So that we can give more, oh God. So that we can draw more people towards you, oh God. It's not about us. It's about you, God. So even in this area of finances, today, God, we want to surrender it all to you. It is yours anyway. We recognize you as the source. Right now we want to give it all back to you again. Whatever we have, we lay at your feet, oh God. Our wealth, we lay at your feet. Our debts, we lay at your feet, oh God. God, do with it what you please, oh God. Use whatever we have in our life to please you, to glorify you, oh God. God, I thank you for this time when we can gather and hear from you. God, even as your word is spoken, that it will be sent forth, it will accomplish its purposes, oh God. It will not return void. We thank you for all who are here, God. We pray that even as they walk out from this place, they will remember that no financial problem has defeated them. We are victorious in you, oh God. You have overcome everything. So as we go out, oh God, God begin to make paths straight, begin to open doors for us, for all our church members, whether maybe some of them are not even here today, but begin to open doors, oh God. God, we thank you for this time. We also want to continue to pray for the time to follow. Even as we fellowship around the food and the table, God, I pray that you bless our time of fellowship until we meet again, oh God. In Jesus' name I pray. Yeah. Amen. So guys, don't leave straight away. Please stay back. We're going to have food out.